I want to read a few verses. I believe that people should get the credit they deserve for things that happen. And sometimes we don't give credit where credit's due. But in the first chapter of James, beginning in the 12th verse, it said, "Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him." When you go through temptation, you endure it, the Lord will give you a crown of life if we endure. Verse 13 says, "Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, nor tempteth he any man." So when we have evil in our life or bad things that happen and we want to say God did this and God said that, no, he didn't. God didn't bring that upon us. We need to give the credit to Satan who tempts us with evil. 14 says, "But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. That when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brother." Know where your gifts are coming from. And if we read here in verse 17, it says that every good gift and every perfect gift, which is complete, is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadows nor turning. And we have tough times in our life, and we have things happen to us, and sometimes we're following our own ways, our own lust, and Satan will abide us and will oblige us, I mean to say, but we don't need to blame that on God. God cannot tempt us with evil, but the good and perfect gifts is what he sends. At this time, Brother Dan, to bring your message.
Thank you, Brother Tom. I'd ask you to go ahead and turn to 345 in your songbook today. This will be our song of invitation. During that closing song, if there's anybody here that's not a Christian, we want to give you an opportunity to give your life to Christ. We're told throughout the scriptures that we need to hear God's word. It's the gospel that calls us to salvation. And it's only through his word. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So it's through the gospel that we can receive salvation. And once we hear the gospel and we understand it to a certain point, we don't have to understand it all. I 30 years, I haven't got it yet. So we hear the word, but then we have to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. That has to be a strong faith for us. It has to be an obedient faith. We're also told we need to repent, which is to turn your life around. Make a commitment to the Lord. That you want to start living your life for him. And you can do that right where you sit. So all of those things can be done wherever. We're also told, though, in the scriptures that Jesus says that we need to confess him before man. So we need to make that great confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And after we do that, we need to be baptized for remission of sins. I can go a lot of places in the scriptures for all of these things and show you right where they are. And I want to pick up from there today, and actually, because we're also told we need to endure to the end. We need to be faithful to the end to receive the crown of life. So as Christians, we still have to continue to live our lives for the Lord, and we need to go to his word, and we need to know how to live our lives for the Lord. You know, we wear a bracelet that says WWJD, but if we don't go to the scriptures, we don't know what Jesus would do in any given situation. So we need to continue in God's word, in the scriptures. I guess I'm kind of continuing with what Tom was just now preaching on and what he had for Sunday school. It's all kind of, anybody that's been here for Sunday school, and I think you were all here just a minute ago when Tom was up here, but it's kind of a continuation. It's this world that we live in today is a rough place to live. And it's getting more and more difficult for Christians to live in this world because of the way things are going. We're just getting further and further away from the Lord. Jimmy has mentioned before, you know, you don't have to come out and say, you know, when we start getting rid of God in this world, you know, we kick him out of our schools, we kick him out of everything that we do. And God doesn't have to come down and throw fire and brimstone on us. All he has to do is withdraw his hand and leave us to our own devices. That's all he has to do. This world is a difficult place, and it is getting worse and worse. We got Venezuela, one of the greatest countries, a big oil country, very wealthy. Just in the last decade and a half, they have gone from that to having riots because they don't have electricity. They don't have water to drink. It's not just limited to the countries. We see the same kind of things going on in the United States and in all the states. We see it in our cities and towns, and yes, we see it in our churches. Churches are struggling today. Everywhere. We have ministers that don't believe that there's an actual hell, that stand in the pulpits and say there's no such thing as hell. We have people that all the time think that everybody's going to heaven. God is a gracious God. God's not going to force somebody to go to hell. And you know, God doesn't force anybody to go to hell. He gives every one of us a choice where we want to spend eternity. And if we reject him, we have requested to go to hell. And he's going to let us, because that's what we've chosen. Chapter 3 of 2 Timothy. I'd like to follow along. It says, "This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come." Perilous times are the difficult times, the dangerous times, the savage times, the harsh times. And it says that that will happen in the last days. So what are the last days? Is it like the week before Jesus returns? No, the last days, to me, scripturally, normally refers to the last dispensation in time. Paul wrote this to Timothy, and he said, shall come, so it was in the future at that time. But they've been coming throughout the entire Christian era, which is the last days, according to the scriptures. We are in the last days, so we can expect perilous times to come. We can expect difficult times. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. People care so much about themselves, and that's back in, I think, the 70s, a man wrote a book about how we should take care of number one. Don't worry about anybody else. Just take care of yourself. Love yourself. Do what's good for you. Covetous. We want. We want anything that we don't already have. We're greedy. We're boasters and proud. We want to stand up and say, look what I did. You know, we hear about people that refer to themselves as self-made men. I've heard it in the news here about self-made women this past week several times. Who is a self-made man or a self-made woman? God is the one that helps make us who we are today. He's the one that made us in the first place. And without him, we're nothing. Blasphemers. The language that goes on nowadays. People denying God. People saying there is no God. Disobedient to parents. You know, first I want to say there's a lot of good kids out there still. A whole lot of them. But the disrespect that we see from so many for their parents. They do whatever they want to do. They don't care what their parents tell them to do. They're their own little selves, and they're like us. We're more concerned about our own selves than anybody else. They're disrespectful to teachers. They're disrespectful to adults in general. But I'm not blaming the kids. It's not the kids' fault. You know, when they can go to a store and say, I want that, I gotta have it. And we give in to them. Yeah, papaws do that too. You give in to them and get it for them. They got all this kind of stuff. Everything they want to do, they kick their feet or whatever it might be, or they whine, and we give in to them. Of course they don't have any respect for us. You know, when I was little, when supper was on the table, I ate it or I didn't eat. Today it's short order. That's the way it is around the house. They snack all day long and they get whatever they want. It's not the children's fault. Parents need to stand up and punish their kids. And I know that's difficult to punish a child the way they ought to be punished today. Because there's going to be sociologists and social workers and stuff telling us we're doing wrong. Now, some people do wrong, so those people are, you know, necessary. But you hear on the news that it's child brutality to spank a child. You can't be doing those kind of things. They get after us for it. So people are afraid to punish their kids. They're afraid that... There was a lady recently that bought ice cream for her kids. And they didn't say thank you to the lady that gave it to them. So she threw their ice cream in the trash can. This made the news and everybody talked about what a terrible mom she was. Because just because her kids didn't say thank you, she threw their ice cream away. Disobedient to parents, unthankful. We as adults are unthankful as well. The things that we have in this world, we're still covetous, as it said up there too. Yet look at all the trappings and everything that we have. We are so blessed. But we're not thankful for it. You know, the scriptures tell about 10 men that had leprosy and Jesus healed them. And 9 of them were unthankful. They just walked away. One came back and said, thank you. Unholy. Many that pretend to be righteous, but inwardly they're not. They don't follow the scriptures. They do their own thing. They do whatever they want to. They're hypocrites. Without natural affection. Without natural affection, from what I've studied on it, is natural affection is a child's affection for their parents. That type of thing would be natural affection. And that's going by the wayside. So many children today don't even know their fathers. You know, and their mothers are working 3 jobs, so they don't see their mothers. And they get involved in these gangs, and the way the gangs work, they come up to somebody and they say, hey, we'll be your brothers, we'll take care of you, we got your back, we'll love you. It's something they don't get at home, so they get in this gang. Truce breakers. Most everybody here, I think, remembers when you used to a handshake and a promise was good enough. And now people write contracts for everything that they do. And then after they get into this contract, they start looking for loopholes to get out of it. People don't want to make promises anymore. Used to be, let your yea be yea and your nay nay, and that was good enough. False accusers. That comes from the word diablos, which means the devil. The father of lies. False accusers. Incontinent or lacking self-control. You know, a lot of people don't have self-control these days. I think about when somebody tells me, well, you made me mad. You don't make somebody else mad. They allow themselves to get mad. Brother James used to tell us that all the time. You allow yourself to get mad. You know, with all this road rage that's going on today, you see it all over the place. People driving down the road and somebody does something a little wrong, so they try to run them off the road. They take a gun out and shoot them as they're driving by. People just don't have any self-control anymore. They're in a hurry. They're looking out for number one, going back to lovers of their own selves. They want to get someplace, and somebody's slowing them down, so they get upset about it. They lose off self-control. They're fierce. Fierce means savage, and these are actually words that are synonymous with the perilous, when we're talking about the perilous times. Savage doesn't necessarily mean somebody that is physically savage, but they could be savage towards somebody that says, hey, I'm a Christian, and they don't believe in God, and they don't want you to have your rights in the religious sense, so they're fierce against you. Despisers of those that do good, and that can go along with fierce. Those that don't think people ought to be going around doing good. But there's people in the world like that today that don't care about anything good. Traitors. Backstabbers. You know, two people might be best friends and one of them's doing something a little bit wrong. And this other one says, hey, do you think you ought to be doing that? And this person gets upset and gets totally mad at him and won't have anything to do with them anymore. They're traitors. They'll stab their best friend in the back. Heady. I'm probably guilty here. It's doing things without thinking. We need to pay attention to what we're doing. We need to think about the things that we do. High-minded. This goes back to proud. It's about the same thing, which was already mentioned. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. You know, it's Moses said he would rather live for God than enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. In 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 11, we're told, for this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believed not in the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. They didn't believe the truth because they wanted to go out and do their own thing. They wanted to have pleasure in the things of the world. And people today are more concerned about the pleasure of the things in the world than the pleasure to come, which will be in heaven. Having a form of godliness. A lot of people today are religious, but not according to the truth, not according to God's word. And that's where we need to go to find out how we're supposed to live our lives for the Lord. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power of such. People changing what God's word says. It's done in the pulpits today. People go to the scriptures and twist it around to make it mean whatever they want it to mean. They throw out the parts they don't like. They don't want to have anything to do with it. And then we're told here, from such turn away. Don't follow the people that aren't in the scriptures. Make sure that what's being said is according to God's word. Go to the word yourself and look it up. When somebody tells you something, say, where's that at in the scripture? I never heard that before. Or where's that at in the scriptures? I've heard that all my life, but I've never found it. Can you help me find it? We need to go according to the scriptures. For of this sort, all these that we've been reading about, all these things that people are turning away from the Lord and doing the things of this world. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead silly women captive, silly women laden with sins, lead captive, silly women laden with sins, led away with divers lusts. This is speaking of women here. It's ones that are already caught up in sin. Ones that are already doing things they shouldn't. And there's people coming in and trying to take advantage of them. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of truth. People that learn all the time. And we can even take that to scriptures. In Romans 16, 17, and 18, it says, now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not the Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple, or those that are naive. Through scriptures, people will twist things around. People will tell things that make themselves look good rather than going to the scriptures and preaching Jesus Christ. That's part of people serving their own selves, being boasters and high-minded. I think with this ever learning and never coming to the knowledge of the truth, I think of the Athenians, who always spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. It's in Acts 17. That's what they did. They sat around and wanted to hear something new. It's actually why they listened to Paul when he came in and told them about the unknown God. Verse 8. Now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, and that's not, we don't find that in the scriptures, but according to Jewish writings, older Jewish writings, these are Pharaoh's magicians. If you remember in chapter 7 of Exodus, Aaron threw down a rod, and the rod turned to a serpent, and he had two magicians standing by, and they took their rods, and they threw them down, and they turned into serpents too. Of course, Aaron's staff ate the other serpents. But as they withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. The people, again, talking about in previous verses. They resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. They're unfit in the faith. They're not following the Lord. They're not doing the things that God would have them to do. But they shall proceed no further. They, again, referring to the people that do all these things, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs was. Theirs being Jannes and Jambres. In the same way that theirs was. It'll be made known. People are going to know. But thou hast fully known my doctrine. Again, this is Paul writing to Timothy, a young minister. And he says, you have fully known my doctrine. You're following my doctrine, Timothy. You know what my doctrine is. My manner of life. You know, your doctrine and your manner of life should always be the same. You shouldn't be preaching one thing and going out and living some other way. As Christians, we shouldn't come in here just on Sunday morning and say we're Christians and then go out in the world and live your life however you want to the rest of the week. We need to be Christians 24/7. When people talk to us, they should know that we're Christians. When we respond to them in different things that are being talked about, say, well, now, you know, the Lord says, or the scriptures say, a lot of people say, whoa, I don't want to do that. Can't do that at work. You let people know how you believe, they're telling you how they believe. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, my manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience. Timothy traveled with Paul a long time. Timothy knew the difficult times, the long-suffering, the patience, the faith that Paul had. He knew it firsthand because he was right there with him when he was beaten. Persecutions, afflictions, he says, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra. These are three places where Timothy was with him. So these are places that Timothy would understand. What persecutions I endured. But out of them all, the Lord delivered me. There's the hope. That's what we have too. The tribulations, the difficult times we're going through. The Lord will deliver us. Jesus himself in John 16, the last verse, said, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Jesus overcame the world. The Lord delivered Paul out of all his afflictions. and he'll do the same for us. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Now, who's going to suffer persecution? Those that live godly in Christ Jesus. We need to live godly. Living godly in Christ Jesus is standing up for what's right and saying what's wrong is wrong. It's not anything difficult, but it's something we need to do as Christians. In Acts 14:22, we're told we must, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God. And we're also told in Acts 5:44, we read about the apostles. They had been out preaching the word, and they were locked up for it, and they were going to beat them or whatever. They were deciding what to do with them, and Gamaliel said, hey, let's give them a little space. You know, this has happened before. If this is of God, there's nothing we can do about it. If it's of man, it's going to come to naught. So let's forget about it. So they beat them, and they commanded that they should not speak in the name of Jesus, and they let them go. Then we're told in verse 41 of Acts 5, and they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. They were rejoicing because they were beaten and thrown in prison. Because they were suffering for the Lord. They were doing what the Lord would have them to do. And I'm always brought back, when I talk about tribulation and everything, I look at Romans 8:18. For I reckon that the suffering of this present life is not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. We have a glory for us in heaven. It's waiting for us. We need to continue faithfully as Christians. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. In Matthew 24:24, we're told, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. There are people out there today that are waxing worse and worse, becoming more and more evil. As Christians, we need to continue to follow righteousness. And it does make it harder when the people in the world come at you and say, that's silly. You don't need to be doing those things. Don't you know this is a new era in time? Things change. God's word does not change. We've got it in front of us, and it's not going to change. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Again, Timothy, he was raised by his mother and his grandmother, and they taught him the scriptures. It's in chapter 1 of the same book. They taught him the scriptures. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures. He would have learned the Old Testament at that time as a child. He was one of those people in the time when Jesus came. He lived during the time of trying to go from Old Testament and follow the Jewish ways and follow the God of the Jews to accepting Jesus Christ as that Messiah that was promised. But that's the thing. The Old Testament scriptures foretold of a coming Savior, Jesus Christ. They told about his coming. And Timothy understood that. And those are the things that made him wise unto salvation, through faith which is in Christ Jesus. We're wise if we accept those things through faith. And it has to be in Christ Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father except by me. It's only through Jesus Christ that we can receive salvation. Verse 16 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Everything that's mentioned there. If we need reproof, if we need to go find doctrine, if we need correction in something, if we need instruction in how to be righteous, we can go to the scriptures. It's right here for us. This right here is the answer to all the troubles in the world today.
All of them. Yeah, we're going through difficult times because we kicked God out. We don't want to have anything to do with him anymore. We can do things on our own. We're self-made men and women. We don't need God.
We have his word right here in front of us. We're told that the man of God may be perfect or complete, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. We need to run the race today. We need to be faithful unto death. Hebrews chapter 12, the first couple verses. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and every sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. We need to be patient, but we need to keep running. It's a marathon. It's not a sprint. It's a marathon. And here's the reason why. Verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Look what he endured. He died on the cross for us. None of us have ever gone through anything like that. It says, despising the shame, and is set down on the right hand of the throne of God. This verse just always messes with my mind. The joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. He knew what joy there was going to be in heaven with the Father and with all of those that accept him as Lord and Savior. He wants us to be there with him. We're told that the Lord takes pleasure in the death of his saints. He likes it when the saints pass away. He knows they're coming to him. He doesn't like it when other people pass away, because he knows where they're going. Because he gave them a choice, and they've made a decision. And he's going to honor that choice, whatever it might be. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways and thoughts are so much greater than ours. And we need to follow his ways and his thoughts. We need to do what the Lord says and continue faithful unto death to receive that crown of life. This time, let us stand and sing our song of invitation. Again, if there's anyone here that's not a Christian, you hear the word, you believe, you repent, you confess Jesus Christ before men and be baptized for remission of sins. And you can know the joy that is the joy of a Christian. It's a joy unspeakable. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound.